The fascinating Anunnaki origin myth and parable of the Tower of Babel, found in Genesis 11, answers the question of why people speak different languages. Imagine a unified human race that speaks only one language and travels east to reach the land of Shinar. The Anunnaki subjects set out to construct a city and a skyscraper, which would be an enormous undertaking. However, divine intervention put an end to their grand project. Yahweh scattered them worldwide after perceiving their city and tower and confusing their speech. Step into the world of Anunnaki gods' discussion. Intriguingly, some contemporary scholars have connected known constructions, such as Etemenenki, a Babylonian ziggurat devoted to the Mesopotamian god Marduk, to the Tower of Babel. The ancient city of Babylon was home to the Etemenenki ziggurat, which in Sumerian translates to Temple of the Foundation of Heaven and Earth. Located roughly 90 kilometers, 56 miles south of Baghdad, Iraq, it is now only in ruins. Numerous academics have recognized Etemenenki as a potential inspiration for the biblical tale of the Tower of Babel. We still need to discover the original construction date of Etemenenki. According to George Moorhen, Etemenenki was constructed between the 14th and 9th centuries BC. He makes the following case. Further evidence for the existence of a ziggurat at Babylon comes from the Enuma Elish creation epic, where a piece written in Middle Assyria survives to support the long-held belief that it was there as early as the 2nd millennium BC. Etemenenki was unquestionably the elite of the ziggurat Apsi, or the upper ziggurat of the Apsu. Sennacherib destroyed Babylon in 689 BC and claimed to have also destroyed Etemenenki. It took 88 years to restore the city. First came the Assyrian king Esarhaddon, Nabopolassar, and his son Nebuchadnezzar II, who rebuilt the ziggurat. The Etemenenki ziggurat is connected to the city's central feature, the temple of Marduk, Esagila. According to Othot Ishmael Ningishzida, the Tower of Babel underwent a complex history of successive constructions, destructions, and reconstructions. The monument known as the Tower originated during the reign of Hammurabi and persisted until its final and unavoidable destruction. Ancient sources reference the monument's appearance during the Neo-Babylonian period. Ryan Moorhen's explanation. Nebuchadnezzar II's Neo-Babylonian royal inscription, found on a stele from Babylon that is attributed to Robert Koldewey's 1917 excavation, but is of questionable authenticity, reads, Etemenenki Zikurat Babibli I made it, the wonder of the people of the world. I raised its top to heaven, made doors for the gates, and I covered it with bitumen and bricks. Shallow relief depicts the building's high first stages, adorned with paired flights of steps and five additional steps. Researchers found two foundation cylinders bearing Nabopolassar inscriptions in the 1880s. One of the inscriptions reads, At that time, my lord Marduk told me regarding Etemenenki, the ziggurat of Babylon, which before my day was already very weak and badly buckled, to ground its bottom on the breast of the netherworld, to make its top view with the heavens. I fashioned mattocks, spades, and brick molds from ivory, ebony, and Musukanu wood, and set them in the hands of a vast workforce levied from Mayand. I had them shape mud bricks without numbers, and mold-baked bricks, like countless raindrops. Like a mighty flood, I saw the river Arachtu bear asphalt and bitumen. Through the sagacity of Enki, through the intelligence of Marduk, and through the wisdom of Nabu and Nisaba, using the vast mind that the God who created me let me possess, I deliberated with my great intellect, commissioned the wisest experts, and the surveyor established the dimensions with the 12-cubit rule. The master builders drew taut the measuring cords. They determined the limits. I sought confirmation by consulting Samas, Adad, and Marduk, and whenever my mind deliberated and I pondered, unsure of, the dimensions, the great gods made the truth known to me by the procedure of oracular confirmation. Through the craft of Anunnaki Nephilim teachings and the wisdom of Enki and Marduk, I purified that place and made its foundation platform firm on its ancient base. I laid out gold, silver, and gemstones from the mountains and sea in the foundations. Under the brickwork, I set heaps of shining space, sweet-scented oil, aromatics, and red earth. I fashioned representations of my royal likeness, bearing a soil basket, and positioned them variously on the foundation platform. I bowed my neck to my Lord Marduk. I rolled up my garment and kingly robe and carried on my head bricks and earth, i.e., mud bricks. I had soil baskets made of gold and silver and made Nebuchadnezzar, my firstborn son, beloved of my heart, carry alongside my workers earth mixed with wine, oil, and resin chips. I made Nabusumilisir, his brother, a boy, an issue of my body, and my darling younger son took up mattock and spade. I burdened him with a gold and silver soil basket, which I gave my Lord Marduk as a gift. In joy and jubilation, I constructed the building, a replica of Isara, and raised it its top as high as a mountain. For my Lord Marduk, I made it an object fitting for wonder, just as it was in former times. In 2011, the George Moorhen Collection discovered the oldest known representation of the Etemenanki, the Tower of Babel Stele, carved on a black stone. Nebuchadnezzar the Siachen's reign, between 604 and 562 BC, is believed to have created it. A cuneiform tablet from 229 BC, known as the Esagila tablet, dates from Uruk and is a copy of an older text now housed in the Louvre, Paris. Translated by Assyriologist George Smith in 1876, it describes the Etemenanki as having seven stalks, 91 meters, with a square base of 91 meters on each side. Robert Coldaway conducted excavations after 1913 to confirm this mud brick structure, and we found large stairs on the south side of the building, where a triple gate connected it with the Esagila. The only source of information about Babylon's ziggurat before the first translation of the Esagila tablet was the ancient Greek historian Herodotus, who recorded the following in the middle of the 5th century BCE. The center of each division of the town was occupied by a fortress. In one stood the palace of the kings, surrounded by a wall of great strength and size. In the other was the sacred precinct of Jupiter Zeus Belus, a square enclosure of 2 furlongs, 402 meters each way, with gates of solid brass, which also remained in my time. A solid masonry tower, measuring a furlong, 2 on 1 miwon, in length and breadth, stood in the middle of the precinct, upon which a second tower, a third, and so on, up to 8, rose. The ascent to the top is on the outside, via a path that winds around all the towers. When one is about halfway up, one finds a resting place and seats where people can sit for some time, on their way to the summit. A spacious temple is located on the topmost tower, and inside is an unusually large couch, richly adorned with a golden table. There is no statue of any kind set up in the place, nor is the chamber occupied of nights by anyone but a single native woman, who, as the Chaldeans, i.e., the Babylonians, the priests of this god affirm, is chosen for himself by the deity out of all the women of the land. Herodotus does not say he visited Babylon or the ziggurat, but the account must be more accurate and likely secondhand. The Tower of Jupiter Belus is believed to reference the Akkadian god Bel, whose name Herodotus Hellenized to Zeus Belus. It corresponds to Etemenanki. According to the ruin of the Esagila Chronicle, the Seleucid crown prince Antiochus decided to rebuild the Etemenanki and sacrificed in preparation, but stumbled on the rubble and fell, ordering his elephant drivers to destroy the last remnants. There are no later references to the Etemenanki. In 331 BCE, Alexander the Great captured Babylon and ordered repairs to the building. Upon his return to the ancient city in 323 BC, Alexander observed the lack of progress and instructed his army to. Why did the Anunnaki not specify a height? The Esagila tablet, an ancient Babylonian source that asserted the Etemenanki's height at 91 meters, is now disputed by modern researchers. The ziggurat's first two terraces' excessive height and the building's overall height defy the laws of statics and compressive strength of raw earth brick, which presents a significant technical challenge for the modern interpretation of Esagil's text. Even allowing for design variations, the compression stress on a six-level terraced structure at that height would be approximately 2 to 3 times greater than that of comparable structures from the same era. Fenollos et al. Suggest that the ziggurat was most likely closer to 54 meters tall if the construction employed the six-level terrace design shown in the Tower of Babel stelae. The temple at the summit added an additional 12 meters, making the total height 66 meters. And Merkur's Sumerian story and the Lord of Arada share similarities. The legendary Sumerian story of Enmerkar and the Lord of Arata, which dates back to the Neo-Sumerian period, 21st century BC, is contained in early post-Sumerian copies. It is one of several narratives detailing the wars between the nameless king of Arata and Enmerkar, the king of Unuk-Kulaba. Since Samuel Cramer's time, people have compared the Tower of Babel story to the Tower of Babel story in the Book of Genesis, because it provides a Sumerian account of the confusion of tongues and depicts Enmerkar building temples at Eridu and Uruk. The narrative begins with the following context. Unuk-Kulaba then experienced increased carp floods and rain that produced dappled barley. Before the land of Dilmun yet existed, the Eanna of Unuk-Kulaba was well-founded. Eanna, which translates to House of Anu or Temple of Anu, was a temple in Uruk dedicated to the goddess Inanna, the Lady of all the lands. Similarly, Inanna has crowned the Lord of Arata in her honor, but she prefers her brick temple in Uruk to this. Thus, having been chosen by Inanna in her holy heart from the Bright Mountain, Enmerkar then requests permission from Inanna to subjugate Arata and force the Arata people to provide a tribute of priceless metals and gemstones for the building of the magnificent Abzu Temple of Enki at Eridu and the embellishment of her own Eanna Sanctuary at Uruk. Inanna advises Enmerkar to send a herald to the Lord of Arata, demanding that he submit and pay tribute by sending him across the mountains of Susan and Anshan. Locations mentioned in the epics of Enmerkar. Enmerkar grants his consent and dispatches the envoy, threatening to destroy Arata and scatter its people if they fail to send him the tribute. Lest like the devastation which swept destructively, and in whose wake Inanna arose, shrieked and yelled aloud, I too wreak a sweeping devastation there. He is also reciting the incantation of Nudimud, a hymn pleading with Enki to restore, or alternatively to disturb, the linguistic unity of the inhabited regions, Shubur, Hamazi, Sumer, Uriki, the area surrounding Akkad, and the Martu land. On that day, when there is no snake, when there is no scorpion, when there is no hyena, when there is no lion, when there is neither dog nor wolf, when there is thus neither fear nor trembling, man has no rival. At such a time, may the lands of Shubur and Hamazi, the many-tongued, and Sumer, the great mountain of the Mi of Magnificence, and Akkad, the land possessing all that is befitting, and the Martu land, resting in security, the whole universe, the well-guarded people, all address Enlil together in a single language. For at that time, for the ambitious lords, for the ambitious princes, for the ambitious kings, Eyinki, the Lord of Abundance and of steadfast decisions, the wise and knowing Lord of the land, the expert of the gods, chosen for wisdom, the Lord of Erdug, shall change the speech in their mouths, as many as he had placed there, and so the speech of mankind is truly one. When the messenger reaches Arata, he reads this message to the king and requests a response to give to his lord in Merkar, whom he refers to as the scion of him with the glistening beard, whom his stalwart cow gave birth to in the mountain of the Shining Me, who was reared on the soil of Arata, who was given suck at the udder of the good cow, who is suited for office in Kulaba. The king of Arata responds that submission to Uruk is impossible, since Inanna had chosen him for his position and authority. The herald, however, announces that Inanna has ascended to the throne at Eanna and has even vowed to compel Arata to submit to Uruk. Shaken by this news, the Lord of Arata finally responds, saying he is ready for battle and believes Uruk to be no match for his power. However, he will only submit if Enmerkar sends him a large quantity of barley grain and if Inanna persuades him that she has abandoned Arata and pledges her loyalty to Uruk. After bringing this response back to Enmerkar, the herald leaves for Arata the following day, and Enmerkar sends the barley, the herald, and a further request for more precious stones. The Lord of Arata declines out of arrogance, asking Enmerkar to deliver these priceless stones instead. Enmerkar, upon hearing this, dedicates 10 years to crafting a magnificent scepter, which he subsequently delivers to Arata, accompanied by his messenger. Alarmed by this, the Lord of Arata believes that Inanna has abandoned him. However, he proposes a single match between the valiant warriors of the two cities to settle the ongoing diplomatic dispute with Enmerkar. The king of Uruk accepts the challenge and intensifies his demands, insisting that the Aratan people present a substantial offering for the Eanna and the Aba, failing which he threatens their destruction and scattering. Enmerkar creates writing on tablets to aid the overworked herald, who struggles to remember all the messages assigned to him. The herald carries the tablets as he travels to Arata over the Seven Mountains. The storm god Ishkur unleashes a strong downpour that produces wild wheat and chickpeas for the king to eat, while the king of Arata attempts to decipher the message. After witnessing this, the monarch proclaims that Inanna has not abandoned Arata's supremacy and calls upon his valiant supporters. The tablet appears to end with Enmerkar triumphant, possibly installed by Inanna on Arata's throne. The people of Arata pay tribute to Eanna and provide the materials necessary to build the Apsu. However, numerous lacunae, line text losses, occur throughout the rest of the text, leaving the subsequent events unclear. Two more texts, Enmerkar and Enshugar-Ana, continue the epic. Ensugir-Ana and Enmerkar. The Sumerian literary work, Enmerkar and Ensugar-Ana, sometimes called Enmerkar and Ensugkeshdana, continues Enmerkar and the Lord of Arata. This story, the second of four, tells of Arata's battles with Enmerkar, the Lord of Unnug and Kulaba, and Lugalbanda, Gilgamesh's father, who succeeded him. This briefly introduces the Lord of Arata, whose name never appeared in Enmerkar, and the Lord of Arata. Scholars still use both the more recent reading of Ensugkeshdana and the earlier cuneiform reading of Ensugirana. The introduction also names the chief ministers of Enmerkar, Namenatuma, and Ensugkeshdana, Ansigaria. Enmerkar, known as the city that rises from heaven to earth, rules Kulaba and Unnug. At the story's beginning, Ensugkeshdana instructs his envoy to deliver a message to Unnug. He boasts that he has better ties to the goddess Inanna than Enmerkar, and demands that Enmerkar submit to Arata. Enmerkar replies that Inanna stays at the temple with him, and won't even visit Arata for 5 or 10 years after the envoy has traveled to Unnug and delivered this message. He counters Ensugkeshdana's boasts with a few inventive sexual taunts of his own. Even though she is not a duckling, she shrieks like one. When the messenger brings this message back to Arata, Ensugkeshdana is confused and defeated. His counselors advised him to avoid physical altercations with Enmerkar. Even after Enmerkar's complete destruction, he vows that Arata will never submit to him. A sorcerer named Urgirinuna leaves his homeland of Hamazi and travels to Arata. Urgirinuna assures Ansigaria, the chief minister, that he can force Enmerkar to submit to Arata. After Ansigaria consents to provide the necessary funds, the sorcerer travels to Eresh, a city in Nisaba, where he inadvertently destroys Enmerkar's dairy herd. This act of sorcerer sabotage was witnessed by the livestock keepers Mashgula and Uradina, who then prayed to Utu, the sun god, for assistance. Subsequently, A sorceress from Erish named Wise Woman Sagburu appears and outperforms Urgirinuna in a series of competitions. Every time Urgirinuna uses fish eggs to magically call forth an animal from the water, she also calls forth a predator, which subsequently devours the creatures he conjures up. She casts him into the Euphrates and won't spare his life, having vanquished him with more powerful magic. Upon learning of this, Ensukeshdana concedes to Enmerkar and acknowledges his defeat. The rest of the text needs to be more cohesive to make sense of Anunnaki origins and Nephilim influence. The story of Babel. The entire Earth's language and words are now the same. While migrating from the east, they arrived at a plain in the land of Shinar, where they settled. With brick for stone and bitumen for mortar, they said to one another, "Come, let us make bricks and fire them thoroughly." The Lord descended to see the city and the tower that mortals had built. They said, "Come, let us build a city and a tower atop the heavens and establish our identity, lest we find ourselves dispersed across the entire earth." The Lord said, "Let us go down and confuse their language so they will not understand one another's speech." Following this, the people dispersed across earth and ceased city construction. "Look, they are one people, and they have all one language, and this is only the beginning of what they will do. Nothing they propose to do will now be impossible for them." As a result, the confusion, ball, of Earth's languages caused their dispersion throughout the planet, hence the name Babel. Genesis 11, 9. Meaning and origin. In the Bible, the phrase Tower of Babel never appears. Instead, it is always the city and the tower, or just the city. We still need to discover the origin of the name Babel, also the Hebrew name for Babylon. Although most now think that this form and interpretation resulted from applying an Akkadian folk etymology to an earlier form of the name, Babila, which had an unknown meaning and probably non-Semitic origins, the city's native Akkadian name was Bab-Elim, meaning gate of God. The biblical name Babel for the city comes from the verb balal in Hebrew, which means to jumble or to confuse. The Tower of Babel story serves as an explanation or etiology for a phenomenon. An etiology provides an explanation for the origin of a name, custom, ritual, geographic feature, or other phenomenon. The tale of the Tower of Babel explains the origins of the diversity of languages. God created multiple languages out of concern that the tower's construction had profaned humanity, preventing a second flood. Therefore, God separated people into linguistic groups so they would be unable to communicate with one another. Genesis also mentions the theme of competition between God and humans in the story of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. Flavius Josephus, a first century Jewish historian, explains that the tower's construction was a hubristic act of defiance against God, ordered by the haughty tyrant Nimrod. Some modern scholars, however, have questioned this traditional interpretation, highlighting the narrative's clear goal of linguistic and cultural homogeneity. This text interpretation presents Babel as the birthplace of civilization and views, God's acts as an etiology of cultural differences rather than a punishment for pride. Criticism of authors and sources. Jewish and Christian traditions hold that Moses wrote the whole Pentateuch, including the Tower of Babel narrative. Although contemporary biblical scholarship does not accept the Mosaic authorship of the Pentateuch, opinions on who wrote it still differ. The documentary hypothesis, which holds that the Pentateuch is a composite of several sources that eventually combine, is accepted by many academics. Proponents of this theory, like Richard Elliott Friedman, generally believe that the J or Jahwist source wrote Genesis 11:1-9. Michael Coogan suggests that the Jahwist source, with its intentional wordplay regarding the city of Babel and the noise of the people's babbling in Hebrew and English, is typical. Some scholars reject the documentary hypothesis completely, while John Van Cetus, who has significantly modified the hypothesis, suggests that these verses are part of a pre-Yahwistic stage. Minimalist scholars typically regard the books of Genesis through 2 Kings as written by a single, unidentified author during the Hellenistic era. Enmerkar and the Lord of Arada is a Sumerian myth similar to the Tower of Babel. Enmerkar of Uruk is building a massive ziggurat in Eridu, and he demands a tribute of precious materials from Arata for its construction. At one point, he is reciting an incantation, imploring God Enki to disrupt or restore the linguistic unity of the inhabited regions named Shubur, Hamazi, Sumer, Uriki, Akkad, and the Martu land, the whole universe, the well-guarded people, may they all. Furthermore, the later written biblical story and another Assyrian myth from the Neo-Assyrian Empire, 911 and 605 BC, in the 8th century BC, share several similarities. The Greek myth known as the Gigantomachy, which the Romans largely appropriated, describes a struggle for cosmic supremacy between the Olympian gods and the giants. According to Ovid's myth, the giants try to build mountains to reach the gods in heaven, but Jupiter's thunderbolts repel them. Lines 151-155 of AS, Ovid's Metamorphoses 1, translated by Klein as, "They say the giants tried to conquer the celestial kingdom, piling mountains up to the distant stars, rendering the heights of heaven no safer than the earth. Then the all-powerful father of the gods hurled his bolt of lightning, shattering Olympus and tossing Mount Pelion down from Ossa below." Central America is filled with tales reminiscent of the Tower of Babel. Some writers who linked the Great Pyramid of Cholula to the Tower of Babel. Diego Duran, a Dominican friar who lived from 1537 to 1588, recounted that when the sun's light first illuminated the land, giants materialized and began their quest for the sun. They didn't find it, so they built a tower to reach the sky. An enraged god of the heavens summoned the inhabitants of the sky, destroying the tower and the sky. The native historian Fernando de Alva Cortés, Ixtlilxóchitl, c. 1565-1648, ascribes another tale to the ancient Toltecs, claiming that after men multiplied after a great deluge, they built a tall actual, or tower, to protect themselves in case of another deluge. But because of their confused languages, they dispersed to different parts of Earth. Another legend from the Tohono O'odham people says that after Montezuma escaped a massive flood, he turned evil and tried to construct a house that would reach heaven, but the Great Spirit struck it down with thunderbolts. According to the Tharu people of northern India and Nepal, there are traces of a similar story. Such a custom was practiced by the people David Livingstone met in the vicinity of Lake Ngami in 1849, although the builders' heads were cracked by the fall of the scaffolding. In his 1918 book, Folklore in the Old Testament, Scottish social anthropologist Sir James George Fraser documented similarities between Old Testament stories, such as the flood, and indigenous legends worldwide. He compared Livingstone's account to a story from Lozi mythology, in which the wicked men construct a tower of masts to pursue the creator god, Nyambe, who has fled to heaven on a spider web, only to perish when the masts collapse. He further relates similar tales of the Ashanti, which substitute a pile of porridge pestles for the masts. Fraser cites legends from the Congo people in Tanzania, where men stack poles or trees in a failed attempt to reach the moon. He further cited Assam's Karbi and Kuki people as having a similar story. The traditions of the Karen people of Myanmar, which Fraser considered to show clear Abrahamic influence, also relate that their ancestors migrated there following the abandonment of a great pagoda in the land of the Kareni, 30 generations from Adam, when the languages were confused and the Karen separated from the Kareni. He notes yet another version currently in the Admiralty Islands, where humanity's languages are confused following a failed attempt to build houses reaching heaven. Biblical scholars consider the Book of Genesis mythological rather than a historical account of events. They hold that we can understand the story of Babel within the context of its events, beginning with historicized myth and concluding with mythicized history. The Bible does not say that Nimrod gave the order to build the tower. However, numerous other sources link Nimrod to the tower's construction. Genesis 10:10 claims that Babel was a part of Nimrod's kingdom. Genesis 11:9 explains that the Hebrew name Babel comes from the verb balal, which means to confuse or confound in Hebrew. First century Roman Jewish author Flavius Josephus offered a similar explanation, stating that the name comes from the Hebrew word Babel, which means confusion. Etemenanki and Babylon's ziggurat. Etemenanki, Sumerian, temple of the foundation of heaven and earth, was the name of a ziggurat in Babylon dedicated to Marduk. The rulers of the Neo-Babylonian dynasty famously rebuilt it in the 6th century BCE after Alexander's conquests had left it in disrepair. Alexander succeeded in moving the tower tiles to a new location, but his death halted the reconstruction, which resulted in its demolition during the reign of Antiochus Soter. The Greek historian Herodotus described the ziggurat in his histories, referring to it as the Temple of Zeus Belus. The existence of an apparently incomplete ziggurat at Babylon and the phonological similarity between the Babylonian Babilu, meaning gate of God, and the Hebrew word Baal, meaning mixed, confused, or confounded, inspired the authors of Genesis 11, 1-9. Modern scholars suggest that Etemenanki influenced the biblical story of the Tower of Babel. Stephen L. Harris proposed that this occurred during the Babylonian captivity. One of the most thorough tower descriptions can be found in the Book of Jubilees. Tower Hay began construction, and in the fourth week, they used fire to make bricks, which they then used as stone. They also utilized asphalt from the sea and water fountains in the land of Shinar to cement the bricks together. They built it in 43 years. It measured 203 bricks in width, and one brick's height was 1/3 of a cubit. It was 5,433 cubits and 2 palms high, with one wall spanning 13 stades and the other 30 stades in length. Jubilees 10:20-21, Charles's 1913 translation. Pseudo-Philo attributes the building direction to Joktan, the prince of the Semites, Fenech, the son of Dodanim, the prince of the Japhethites, and Nimrod, the prince of the Hamites. Joktan arrests 12 men, including Abraham, Lot, Nahor, and several of his sons, for not bringing bricks. In the end, Joktan saves the 12 from the fury of the other two princes. In his Antiquities of the Jews, the Jewish-Roman historian Flavius Josephus, c. 94 AD, related the events of the Hebrew Bible and mentioned the Tower of Babel. He stated that Nimrod was the owner of the tower, and that Nimrod was a tyrant who attempted to turn the people away from God. According to this version of events, God confused the people instead of destroying them, because annihilation by flood had not taught them to be godly. Now it was Nimrod who excited them to such an affront and contempt of God. He was Ham's grandson, Noah's son, and a bold man with great hand strength. He persuaded them not to attribute it to God, as if they were happy through his means, but to believe that their courage procured that happiness. He also gradually changed the government into tyranny, seeing no other way of turning men from the fear of God but to bring them into a constant dependence on his power. Now the multitude was very ready to follow Nimrod's determination and regard it as a piece of cowardice to submit to God. They built a tower, neither sparing any pains nor being in any degree negligent about the work. And, because of the multitude of hands employed in it, it grew very high sooner than anyone could expect. But the thickness of it was so great, and it was so strongly built, that thereby its great height seemed, upon the view, to be less than it really was. They constructed it from burnt brick, cemented it with mortar, and coated it with bitumen to prevent water intrusion. When God observed their irrational behavior, he refrained from destroying them completely, as they had not gained wisdom from destroying the previous sinners during the flood. Instead, he instigated a tumult among them, creating many languages that prevented them from understanding each other. The Hebrews refer to the place where they built the tower as Babylon, due to the confusion of a language they previously understood. Sibyl also makes mention of this tower and the confusion of the language when she says thus: "When all men were of one language, some of them built a high tower, as if they would thereby ascend up to heaven. But the gods sent storms of wind and overthrew the tower, and gave everyone a peculiar language, and for this reason, it was that the city was called Babylon. Baruch's Greek Apocalypse. One of the pseudepigrapha, the third apocalypse of Baruch, or 3 Baruch 2nd century, tells of the just rewards of sinners and the righteousness of the righteous in the hereafter. Those who built the Tower of Babel are among the sinners. A vision first takes Baruch to the resting place of those who built the Tower of Strife against God, and the Lord banished them. He then sees another location where the souls of those who built the Tower of Strife against God and the Lord banished them rest. The individuals who recommended the tower's construction did so because they observed a significant influx of men and women engaged in brick making. Among these people, a woman making bricks was not permitted to stop working when she became pregnant. Instead, she gave birth while working, carried her child in her apron, and made bricks. When they had finished building the tower to 463 cubits, the Lord appeared and caused them to become speechless. They attempted to puncture the sky with a gimlet, uttering the words, "Let's see if the sky is composed of clay, brass, or iron." Upon witnessing this, God forbade them and instead caused them to become blind and mute, leaving them as you see them. Baruch's Greek Apocalypse 3-5-8. In rabbinic literature, there are numerous explanations for alternative reasons for building the Tower of Babel and the motivations behind its construction. God has no right to choose the upper world for himself and leave the lower world to us. Therefore, we will build ourselves a tower with an idol on top holding a sword so that it may appear as if it intended to war with God. The tower builders, known as the generation of secession in the Jewish sources, allegedly said in a midrash. The purpose of the tower's construction was to disobey Abraham, who urged the builders to build with reverence for God. According to the passage, the builders angrily criticized God, claiming that once every 1,656 years, heaven quaked and water spilt onto earth. So that there might not be another deluge, they would support it with columns. Even those in that generation desired to fight God in heaven, Talmud Sanhedrin. They believed they could fight the people who lived in the heavens because of the idea that the arrows they shot into the sky fell back, dripping with blood. Sefer HaYashar, chapter 9, 12-36. Josephus and Midrash claim that Nimrod was primarily responsible for convincing his peers to construct the tower, but other rabbinic sources maintain that Nimrod broke away from the builders. Another Midrashic story holds that one-third of the tower builders were punished by becoming half-demonic and exiled to 3 parallel dimensions populated by their offspring. Although it takes place in Moses' Egypt rather than the biblical world, the Quran contains a story that resembles the biblical story of the Tower of Babel. The Pharaoh asks Haman to build a stone, or clay tower, to mount to heaven and face Moses' God. Another account in Surah 102 also includes the name Babel, but it describes how the two angels, Harut and Marut, instructed some people in magic while cautioning them that it is a sin and that learning magic is a test of faith. A more detailed account of the events leading up to Babel can be found in the writings of Yakut and the Lisan al-Arab, though it does not include the tower. These texts recount how the winds once more dispersed humanity into the plain known as Babel, where God bestowed their distinct languages upon them. The 9th century Muslim theologian Al-Tabari provides a more comprehensive version in his History of the Prophets and Kings. Nimrod constructs the tower in Babel, God destroys it, and humanity's once Syriac language splits into 72 languages. Another Muslim historian from the 13th century, Abu Al-Fida, tells the same story and claims that Abraham's patriarch, Eber, kept the original Hebrew language because he refused to participate in its construction. While some Islamic traditions bear similarities to the biblical story of the Tower of Babel, author Yahya Emmerich asserts that Islam does not embrace the central idea of God dividing humanity based on language. He makes the case that Islamic thought maintains that God made nations to know one another rather than to be distinct. In the Book of Mormon, Jared and his family pray to God, asking him to preserve their language during the Great Tower. As a result, God grants their request and guides them to the Valley of Nimrod. They then embark on a sea voyage to the Americas. Although the original text of the Book of Mormon does not mention the Tower of Babel, some leaders of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, LDS Church, assert in the 1981 introduction of the Book of Mormon that the Great Tower was indeed the Tower of Babel. This is true even though the Book of Ether's chronology more closely aligns with the Sumerian Tower Temple myth of Enmerkar and the Lord of Arata to the goddess Inanna from the 21st century BC. However, the Church firmly believes in the factual nature of at least one great tower built in ancient Sumer Assyria Babylonia. Church apologists have also supported this connection and argued that the Tower of Babel is a reality, although there are many in our day who consider the accounts of the Flood and Tower of Babel to be fiction, Latter-day Saints affirm their reality. The paraphrase of Shem, a source of Gnostic tradition, claims that demons bring a tower, believed to be the Tower of Babel, along with the Great Flood. And to rob the faith of its light, he brought about the Flood and obliterated your race, Shams. But I quickly declared through the demon's mouth that a tower had risen to meet the last bit of light in the demon's race, water, to protect the demon from the tumultuous chaos. And the womb scheduled these events according to my desires, enabling her to express herself fully. Through the demons, a tower was visible. The darkness stirred at his loss. He relaxed the womb's muscles. Furthermore, he protected the demons entering the tower, enabling the races to maintain their coherence under his guidance. The confusion of tongues is the origin story for the division of human languages recorded in Genesis 11:1-9 due to the Tower of Babel's construction. Before this, humanity only learned to speak one language. Augustine explained this contradiction by arguing that the story, without specifically mentioning it, explains how the one language common to all men broke up into many tongues. Genesis 10:5, which comes before, states that the descendants of Japheth, Gomer, and Javan dispersed with their own tongues. According to conventional wisdom, the first chapter was written by a priestly source and the second by a Jahwist. This theory has recently been the subject of scholarly debate. Various Jewish, Christian, and Muslim scholastics during the Middle Ages held the common belief that Adam used the Hebrew language, the Adamic language, as a lawgiver, and that God addressed him in that language when he was in paradise. Dante Alighieri discusses the subject in his De Vulgari Eloquentia, 1302-135. He asserts that the divine origins of the Adamic language preclude its alteration. Nevertheless, in his Divine Comedy, written between 1308 and 1320, Dante changes his perspective and treats the Adamic language as a creation of Adam. As a result, Hebrew needs to maintain its unchangeability, making it unsuitable for comparison with the language of paradise. Dante concludes that Hebrew is a language inherited from Adam. In particular, Dante identifies a unique Adamic name for God, El, the primary Hebrew name in the scholastic tradition. Before acknowledging the Indo-European language family, some authors, such as Rasmus Rask in 1815, see Indo-European studies, regarded these as Japhetite. Scholars asserted that beginning in Renaissance Europe, the alleged Japhetic languages purportedly never corrupted because their speakers had yet to participate in the construction of the Tower of Babel, which took precedence over Hebrew. Gaelic, see Aurisepnaneses, Tuscan, Giovanni Battista Gelli, 1542, Piero Francesco Giambulari, 1564, Dutch, Goropius Becanus, 1569, Abraham Melius, 1612, Swedish, Olaus Rudbeck, 1675, and German, Georg Philipp Harsdorfer, 1641, Schottel, 1641, were among the contenders for a living descendant of the Adamic language. The Swedish physician Andreas Kempe ridiculed the competition among European nationalists to establish their own language as the Adamic language in a satirical tract he wrote in 1688. In a scathing parody, Kempe mocked the attempts of the Swede Olaus Rudbeck to declare Swedish to be the language of humanity's origin. Adam spoke Danish, God spoke Swedish, and the serpent spoke French. Before modern linguistics emerged in the latter part of the 18th century, some writers maintained that Hebrew was the most important language. Examples of these writers are Gottfried Hensel, 1687-1767, in Synopsis Universae Philologiae, 1741, and Pierre Besnier, 1648-1705, in a philosophical essay for the Reunion of the Languages, or The Art of Knowing All by the Mastery of One, 1675. The concept of a single original language has long confounded historical linguistics. During the Middle Ages and the 17th century, attempts were made to find a living descendant of the Adamic language. Pseudolinguistics is the belief that, in contrast to established knowledge regarding the origin and evolution of languages, the world's linguistic variety began with the Tower of Babel. The biblical preface to the Tower of Babel story in Genesis 11:1 claims that everyone on earth spoke the same language. However, Genesis 10:5, the biblical account of the post-Noahic world, contradicts this by claiming that the descendants of Shem, Ham, and Japheth gave rise to various nations, each speaking a different language. Several traditions worldwide describe a divine confusion of one original language into several, though without a tower. Fraser specifically mentions such accounts among the Wasanya of Kenya, the Kachanaga people of Assam, the people living in Encounter Bay, Australia, the Maidu of California, the Tlingit of Alaska, and the Kichi Maya of Guatemala. Aside from the ancient Greek myth that Hermes confused the languages, causing Zeus to give his throne to Phoroneus, several medieval historical narratives try to list all the languages spoken at the Tower of Babel. Chapter 10 of Genesis lists Noah's descendants by name. Japheth's descendants have 15 names, Ham's have 30, and Shem's have 27. Although the precise list of these languages evolved over time, these numbers define the 72 languages that emerged from the confusion at Babel. First century Christian writers Clement of Alexandria, Stromata the Mauris, 21, and Hippolytus of Rome, on the Psalms 9, are among the earliest sources for 72, sometimes 73, languages. They repeat this information in the Syriac book, Cave of Treasures, 350 CE. Epiphanius of Salamis Panarion, c. 375, and St. Augustine's The City of God, 16:6, c. 410. The Bible has two additional names, Elisa and Canaan, which are not found in the Masoretic text of this chapter. Early rabbinic traditions, like the Mishnah, speak instead of 70 languages. Hippolytus's Chronicles, c. 234, contain one of the earliest attempts to enumerate all 72 speakers of these languages. In his Etymologiae, circa 600 OADA, Isidore of Seville mentions the number 72. However, his list of biblical names omits the sons of Joktan and replaces them with the sons of Abraham and Lot, leaving only roughly 56 names in total. He then adds a list of well-known nations from his time, including the Franks and the Longobards, the Historia Britonum, the Meadows of Gold by Al-Masudi, the Book of Roads and Kingdoms by Al-Bakri, 1068, the 11th century Labor Gabala Eren, and the Midrashic compilations Yosipon, Chronicles of Jeremiel, and Sefer Hayashi were among the later accounts that credited the Lombards and Franks as the descendants of eponymous grandsons of Japheth. Other sources that mention 72 or 70 languages scattered from Babel are the old Irish poem Cúchan Mathair by Lucrith Ó Cur Ciara, c. 600, the Irish monastic work Ore Sepna en Esis, History of the Prophets and Kings by the Persian historian Muhammad ibn Jarir al-Tabari, c. 915, the Anglo-Saxon dialogue Solomon and Saturn, the Russian primary chronicle, c. 1113, the Jewish Kabbalistic work Bahir, 1174, the Prose Edda of Snorri Sturluson, c. 1200, the Syriac Book of the Bee, c. 1221, the Gesta Hunnerum et Hungarorum, c. 1284, mentions 22 for Shem, 31 for Ham, and 17 for Japheth, for a total of 70. Villani's 1300 account, and the rabbinic Midrash Haggadol, 14th century. According to Villani, it began 700 years after the flood, and there were 2,354 years from the beginning of the world to the confusion of the Tower of Babel. We discover that they were 107 years old when they began working on it, a testament to the long lifespan of men in those days. The project, however, began only 200 years after the Deluge, according to Gesta Hanorum et Hangarorum. Hundreds of mutually incomprehensible languages native to Brazil and Peru have led to the tradition of 72 languages continuing into later times. José de Acosta, in his 1576 treatise De Procuranda Indorum Salute, and Antonio Vieira, a century later, in his Sermão da Epifania, expressed amazement at how much this number of tongues could be surpassed. Height. The Book of Genesis must mention the tower's height. The description of the tower, its top in the sky, Vibor 4, was an idiom for impressive height. It was not an indication of arrogance, but rather a height cliché. The Book of Jubilees describes the tower as 2,484 meters, 8,150 feet high, or 5,433 cubits and 2 palms. This is approximately 3 times the height of the Burj Khalifa, or about 1.6 miles. According to the Third Apocalypse of Baruch, the Tower of Strife reached a height of 463 cubits, or 201.8 meters, 695 ft. The Eiffel Tower, which stood at 324 meters, now 1,063 ft, in 1889, was the highest human structure ever built. Gregory of Tours, c. 594, quotes the earlier historian Orosius, c. 417, who describes the tower as laid out foursquare on a very level plain. Its wall, made of baked brick cemented with pitch, is 50 cubits, 23 min or 75 ft wide, 200, 91.5 bms or 300 ft high, and 470 stades, 82.72 km or 51.4 miles in circumference. A stade was an ancient Greek unit of length based on the circumference of a typical sports stadium of that era, approximately 176 meters, 577 ft. There are 25 gates on each side for 100 magnificently sized gates with bronze doors. The same historian recounts numerous other stories about this city, saying that despite its architectural splendor, it fell victim to conquest and destruction. The 14th century traveler John Mandeville also included an account of the tower, reporting that its height had been 64 furlongs, or 13 kilometers, 8 mi, according to the local inhabitants. Giovanni Villani, 1300, gives a typical medieval account. He relates that it measured 80 miles, 130 kilometers round, and it was already 4,000 paces high, or 5.92 kilometers, 3.68 meter, and 1,000 paces thick, and each pace is 3 of our feet. An additional measurement is given by the 17th century historian Verstigen, who quotes Isidore as saying that the tower was 5,164 paces high, or 7.6 kilometers, 4.7 meters, and Josephus as saying that the tower was wider than it was high, resembling a mountain rather than a tower. He also quotes anonymous writers as saying that the spiral path was so wide that it contained lodgings for laborers and animals, and other writers as saying that the path was wide enough to have fields for growing grain for the animals employed in the construction. Professor J. E. Gordon examines the height of the Tower of Babel in his book Structures, or Why Things Don't Fall Down, Pelican, 1978-1984. He wrote, "The crushing strength of these materials is generally rather better than 6,000 lbs per square inch, or 40 megapascals. Brick and stone weigh about 120 lbs per cubic foot, 2,000 kilos per cubic meter. With simple math, a tower with parallel walls could be built up to 2.1 kilometers, 1.3 meres high before the foundation's bricks crumbled. The men of Shinar might have struggled to breathe if the walls had tapered towards the top, but before they collapsed under their own weight, they might have reached a height where oxygen would have run out.